Sehr geehrte Frau
Ms. Schmeider, Mr. Philipp, Mr. Schmidt, Ms. Amanpour, Ambassador, Ladies and Gentlemen, dear Fulbright community, dear guests, this is a moving moment for me, and I would like to thank you for making, in many cases, a very long trip covering very great distances to honor me, and in this way honoring also my home country, Germany. You have found an excellent organization here. When you see Mr. Pauser, who comes from my constituency, Greifswald, after all, is in my constituency, and the sort of story that he told us is a sort of moving story that is in many ways emblematic for today's time. I mean, Greifswald is actually a venerable Hanseatic town, and which the world may not know, but it is part and parcel of this modern world now and is contributing to the world as we know today. And then obviously the greetings of René Fleming, whose voice I cherish so much, having her among us, and you, Ms. Amanpour, with those very gracious words you found for me. I usually only see you on television from a great distance, so thank you for taking the trouble to come here tonight and to put my political work in perspective. Fulbright, the Fulbright Prize is the very symbol of how important international understanding is. Understanding in and of itself obviously is not sufficient, but as one would say in mathematics, it is necessary for a peaceful coexistence on a small scale in one's private life, but also among nations. And William Fulbright, as a young scholarship holder and a student in Oxford, himself experienced how across borders, across continents, getting to know each other fostered understanding and also trust. And against the background of this experience, he initiated shortly after the Second World War a program that to this day is one of the most successful exchange programs the world over. I think we always have to think back to those days when this program was initiated, in the immediate post-war period, a time where one would think that hatred or suspicion would carry the day, but there were still people at the time, and we still benefit from their farsightedness today, who after this catastrophe that was unleashed by the Germans, they still made reconciliation and understanding possible. Understanding, getting to know each other is something that states can promote, but they cannot impose it. And so you always need people to fill this with life, people who show an open-mindedness, who are open to share experiences with others. You need students, you need pupils, you need professors, you need professionals from all walks of life who are bold enough, who are courageous enough to set out into the unknown, to go to other countries, to live there, to work, and to make something out of their lives. And what a rewarding experience it is for each individual if this works out, particularly when new acquaintances become friends, and we know that such experiences will last you a lifetime. Openness towards other cultures and civilizations, empathy towards other nations, also a feeling of gratitude because one was able to broaden one's own horizon. This is what remains. And when you're experienced in another country and its realities, well, you cannot really nurture your preconceived notions. There will be a certain correction mechanism setting in. And it's most important that at this point in time, in this particular moment in time, we do this again. Because if you get to know other countries, if you get to know other people, they will also see you invariably as an ambassador. Because in a way, you lend your face, your voice to the message you carry from your own home country. And then when you come back, you have these experiences that you bring back home that you can share with others. So every successful exchange promotes getting to know and understanding between our countries and is another bond in this most important network of international relations. And Senator Fulbright firmly believed in such a citizens' diplomacy, as it were. The idea not only politicians and diplomats contribute to bringing about peace, but all citizens, all of those who nurture and build on cross-border friendships. Easier said than done. Behind this openness towards the world, however, is a great cultural achievement, an achievement that has been constantly filled with life and continues to be filled with life by Americans and Germans. Many American citizens consider Germany to be their second home. In Berlin alone, 20,000 Americans live. More than 10,000 Germans study at American universities, even more young Americans study in German universities, around 12,600. Americans and Germans study with each other, do research with each other, work, so they renew our relations every day. And the Fulbright program gives a very important contribution to this, a crucial contribution. The exchange with Germany, as it has already been said, is particularly intensive. More than 46,000 scholarships the Fulbright Commission gave to Germans and Americans. And that shows the very great interest our two countries have and the citizens of our two countries have with the respective countries. The United States and Germany are linked by partnership and friendship for more than 70 years. 1946, only 1 year after the end of the Second World War, the Fulbright program was already launched, and that very same year, the then Secretary of State, James Francis Burns, gave a speech in Germany that ended with the following words, and let me quote him, and this in 1946, and I quote, "The American people want to return the government of Germany to the German people. The American people want to help the German people to win their way back to an honorable place among the free and peace-loving nations of the world." End of quote. These words became known as the Speech of Hope, hope for a future for a country that had been destroyed by a war that it had unleashed itself, hope for a country that politically, economically, and morally was completely crushed. But why should one give help to a better future to this country, a former enemy in a war that brought so much suffering over the world? There have always been understandable doubts and reservations throughout our common history. But the fact that the answer that was given was a very positive one was due to extraordinary courage and political farsightedness. Germany was to take its destiny into its own hands again. It was to build up a democracy. It was to grow into a partner that would then become part of a free and prosperous Europe. And this is how our country, in a very special way, experienced how important trust and confidence is. And this is what the United States and also the other Western allies showed to Germany, and they demonstrated it in both words and deeds. The Fulbright program is an expression of this trust. Let me remind all of us on the Marshall Plan and the many Allied soldiers that were stationed during the Cold War in Germany. Let us remember the airlift that 70 years ago, during the blockade of Berlin, supplied the city with vital goods by air, keeping the hope for freedom in the city alive, and the legendary commitment of the American President John F. Kennedy will also never be forgotten. Ich bin ein Berliner. In 2019, on the 9th of November, we shall celebrate the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. We are here at a very symbolic location, as you probably know, very close to the Brandenburg Gate. This gate that was closed for decades and has now been open for the past 30 years is a symbol for the freedom of the city, for unification of Germany, for overcoming the division of Europe, and for all of this happening because of our American friends standing next to us relentlessly, standing up for a free Europe, making this free Europe strong, and we Germans shall never forget this.
Und erst jüngst, als ich
Only recently, when on a very sad occasion I traveled to Washington for the funeral ceremony of George Herbert Walker Bush, we were able to remind ourselves that he was one of the great figures who worked for German unification together with Chancellor Kohl, offering us partnership in leadership at the time. All of this is part and parcel of our history, that is part of our present as well. But we also know that the young generation doesn't see this transatlantic partnership as such a given, as such a matter of course, as the older generation. We know that priorities have shifted, particularly from the American perspective, for a very good reason. The Pacific area is just as much a challenge as the European area. After the end of the Cold War, priorities have shifted somewhat. And that has always been the case in the past, incidentally, as well. We are not always of one and the same opinion as regards pondering and balancing out national and international interests. But allow me, if I may, to tell you that Germany, little by little, in particular after the end of the Cold War, shouldered more responsibility. Christiane Amanpour just reminded us when the first German troops arrived in Kosovo. At the time, this was a very tough fight. I was very much a junior member in the government. We were grappling with whether we should allow ships, vessels to go to the Adriatic Sea with soldiers. These days, it's a matter of course that not only on the Western Balkans we're present with our allies, but also in Afghanistan, because following the invocation of Chapter 5, we are now there with our American allies, and we're in Mali present, and we know that we need to do more. We wish and we want to shoulder responsibility, and we will do so. This is demonstrated by the increasing defense budget and also by the increase in our budget for economic cooperation and development aid. And we want to stand up for our freedom because we also want to defend and stand up for our values. But we also have to be aware of the fact that 80 years after the beginning of the Second World War, many of the lessons of history seem to fade into the background. They no longer seem to be convincing people these days. We have less and less contemporary witnesses of the unimaginable crimes that Germans committed during the National Socialist period, and there are less and less people among us who have their own experience of the avalanche of destruction an inhumane ideology can unleash. Today, therefore, we who are in political responsibility have to show that we have learned the history from the First and Second World War. We have to shoulder responsibility for maintaining and preserving peace in this world, because we can count ourselves lucky that in our countries we are able to live in peace and freedom, but this is not a matter of course. We have to work for this time and time again. We have to remain vigilant, wide awake as regards social developments within our countries, but also outside of our countries. And that too is part and parcel of the analysis of present-day politics, also here in Germany. We do see an increase in excessive populism and nationalism that tends to marginalize others. The thinking in national spheres of influence seems to gain prominence over international humanitarian law. And we have to stand up resolutely against this type of thinking.
Wir sollten und müssen uns noch einmal daran erinnern,
we should,
warum
and we ought to remind ourselves of the fact why the United Nations were established in the first place, why NATO, why the World Trade Organization and other international institutions. Because of the lessons that were drawn out of the horrors of the Second World War and excessive nationalism, acting together, multilateralism, that was the response to the horrors of the first half of the 20th century. And for me, this is still true today. We need international rules in order to settle conflicts of interest peacefully, And in order to be able to do this, we need international institutions that are strong enough to act. Of course, these international organizations also have to be adapted to modern day challenges. They have to be reformed, they have to be further developed, because the challenges of present day reality are changing over time, after all. These are challenges that, and I'm firmly convinced of this, cannot be tackled, cannot be mastered by nations going it alone. These are challenges that we are all duty bound to tackle, to master, and no country can act as if this wasn't concerning it. And I'm saying this also for Germany, or as if this was an inevitable fate that one simply has to accept. No, globalization, digitalization, economic development are made by men, are made by individuals, and wars, crises also are made by human beings. So we should do everything in our power, everything that we as human beings are capable of, to tackle and master these common challenges together. And this is why I always argue the case of in our interconnected world, seeing that there is, of course, a national common good, but there is also a global common good. Obviously, each and every country has its own political priorities, but global needs and necessities and national interests must not be in any way contradictory to each other. I'm quite convinced that working for the global common good also has positive effects on the national common good. And patriotism for me always means thinking your own vested national interests also together with the vested interests of others. And this is why I will never tire of making a case for a strengthening of multilateral, rules-based and value-based global order. This, ladies and gentlemen, also is true for the European Union, because after all, the European Union too was founded because of the lessons learned from the horrors of the 20th century. And this is why, Europe and Germany are multilateral projects, if you like. And we here in Germany know that we can, in the long run, only prosper if Europe also prospers. I'm convinced that the idea of the European integration is the best idea we ever had on this continent.
Natürlich müssen wir auf dem Wege
on this path towards a further development of the European Union, we also have to contend with certain setbacks. The decision of the British citizens to leave the European Union, for example, is one such setback. But we have to respect this, and this is why we will do our utmost, even once Britain has left the European Union, to build good relations to our then neighboring country, built on trust. Theresa May, for a very good reason, says, we remain part of Europe, and this is true for the economic area, it's true for the contacts between our civil societies, in the security area, in the foreign political area, and in many areas where we can forge a very close cooperation. And of course, Europe is sometimes a cumbersome project. I spend many, many nights there in order to try and come to some agreement after long and arduous negotiations, but we've always proved that we are able to strike compromises. So we are finding good, sustainable solutions and responses to questions with which individual countries themselves could not cope. And I mean, we're negotiating time and again also things that we had thought were quite natural. For example, is a compromise a good thing? I think we ought to hold compromises in high regard, because after all, they're absolutely essential. They're crucial for people living together peacefully. We can say Europe is too complicated a project, let's do this in Germany. We will then immediately see that the federal government and the Länder government already need nights in order to negotiate results. Then you say, well, just negotiate with the government. We need, coalition committees that meet overnight. And if you say we don't want any compromise at all, we don't need it outside of politics, well, remember the way that your average family spends the weekend. Without some kind of compromise, you will not be able to agree on lunch and you will not be able to agree on the family outing. So if you want to be on your own all the time, alone, well, then you don't need to strike compromises unless you're a schizophrenic personality, obviously. But the minute you wish to live together with others, a compromise will be necessary. So, ladies and gentlemen, in this world of change, only a united Europe can be a strong Europe, a Europe that holds its own in freedom and self-determination with its values. As a partner and friend of the United States, Europe can only be as strong as it is united. The transatlantic partnership rests on a foundation of shared values, on democracy, on human rights, on freedom. And because this is the case, we, Germany, Europe and the United States could never wish for better partners. And this is in spite of all the differences that one has, as one has them in any kind of partnership, we should never forget. Particularly now, where in our transatlantic relationship, we need to talk with one another. We need meetings, encounters, lines of communication, and such lines of communications we wish to establish with the so-called Germany here that we currently hold in the United States. The motto "Wunderbar together" should allow us to get together with as many Americans as possible. More than 1,000 events will not only take place in the big cities but all over the country. And just as Senator Fulbright, I am firmly convinced that it is meetings among citizens that turn states of the world into a true community of states. So the Fulbright program is not only a blessing for generations of grantees, but also for our relations among our nations. So let me repeat yet again, it is a great honor and privilege for me to be awarded with the Fulbright Prize for International Understanding. The fact that the first awardee was Nelson Mandela obviously makes this an even greater honor. In addition, I am very grateful that so many of you have come such a long way to this award ceremony here in Germany. Maybe Senator Fulbright has never been as modern as he is today. It is a good thing that he was there, and it is a good thing that we commemorate his actions here today. Thank you.